early on the first Easter, when the sun was just rising in the sky, Mary Magdalene, the tears still stinging her eyes, gathered together a few spices. She met her friends on the road, and in that golden hour, just as the sun is rising, they walked to the tomb where Jesus had been buried. They wanted to do one last thing for Jesus, properly prepare his body for burial. And as they walked, no words were needed. They were all sharing the same grief. And when they arrived, they looked at the tomb, expecting to have to move a stone. But the stone was rolled away, and the tomb was empty.
Every street light captures your good side. We're chasing the sunrise to the golden hour. Counting road signs, guided by Helen lines. We're making good time, and the world is ours. I wanna hold you now in the golden hour, and every day's a minute, and every way we're in it. Let me hold you now in the golden hour. Feeling the wheels turn, we're singing a free bird. And some people never learn about this golden hour. Take a picture, 'cause life is a quick burn, and everything's clearer than ever before. I wanna hold you now in the golden hour, and every day's a minute, and every way we're in it. Let me hold you now. Let me hold you now in the golden hour. Let me hold you now in the golden hour. Hold you now in the golden.
The stone is rolled away. The tomb is empty. Christ is risen.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
This is the good news. Once we were no people, now we are God's people.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Jesus Christ is risen today. Alleluia. Our triumphant holy day. Alleluia. Who did once upon the cross. Alleluia. Suffer to redeem our
and welcome to our service on this Easter Sunday on Resurrection Day. It's such a joy that we have so many people taking part in our service today. As usual, we have Evan Smith, who is our music director. My partner in life is here with us, the Reverend Scott Parsons, taking part in our service. And as always, John is taking care of our video. Some new faces for our worship today. We give thanks to Dominic Green, Peter Halley, Shelley Neville, and Abra Whitney, and Quote the Raven, who all helped make our music for this service come to life. Donations are always greatly appreciated, and your generosity is appreciated. If you would like to support our ongoing ministries here at Cochrane Street, you can send us an e-transfer, and the email will be at the end of our worship video. But also, you can check out our website and check out the donate button, which will have all the information you need. Old-fashioned tools work just as well. You can drop off your donations at 81 Cochrane Street or send them in the mail. We also give thanks for the ways that we can worship together. And in good news, we are coming up on April 11th, where we are going to continue to be online, but also in person.
There will be an email coming out on Tuesday morning about how to register. Unlike the last alert level, we can only have 50 people, so it will be super important for you to register each week. So Tuesday morning, you'll get an email with all the details on how to register. One of the great initiatives of the United Church of Canada is working towards encouraging our governments to move to a guaranteed livable income. There was a link in your congregational email, and I'd encourage you to check out the information and perhaps send the letters that are needed so that we can make this change in our society.
The light of Christ is with us.
Here, now, in this place.
In Christ, though we are many,
we are one.
Let our hospitality towards each other reflect God's love. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another in the peace of Christ.
As we gather today, you can take some time to greet those who are joining you in worship today, or call someone you love and share the peace of Christ with them.
This is the day that God has made. We will rejoice and be glad. This is the day that God has made. We will rejoice and be glad. Sing hallelujah. Sing in hallelujah. Sing in hallelujah. We will rejoice and be glad. Sing in hallelujah. Sing in hallelujah. Sing in hallelujah. We will rejoice and be glad.
Let us pray. God of empty tombs, this day is like every other day. Alarm clocks beep, covers removed, coffee brewed, weary bodies came to life. And yet this day is like no other day, for the sun rose and we knew it was a miracle. The tomb was empty and they knew it was love. So again and again we say, the longest night is over, death has lost its sting. Jesus is among us. Alleluia and amen.
join together in our prayer of confession. Beloved friend, before God and before each other, we confess. We have seen the sun rise and withheld our praise. We have seen our neighbors suffer and withheld our aid. We have seen love extended and chosen to walk away. We have seen divisions deepen and managed to remain unfazed. Open our hearts to your way. Amen. Friends, you are forgiven. God's love is like the sun. No matter how lost we are in the night, day after day, the light will find you. Rest easy. You are held in God's warmth. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. Amen. Amen.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to our learning time together. I hope you're all doing well on this Easter Sunday. You'll notice I have some special guests with me today. I've got Lauren. And what's your job here at First Light, Lauren?
I'm the arts technician at First Light.
Excellent. And I've got John here. John is usually behind the camera, but many of you might not know, but our music director, the amazing Evan Smith, had his birthday this week. And Evan usually has to sing for his own birthday, but John and Lauren have agreed to help us sing happy birthday to Evan and to all of you who had a birthday this week. So we're going to sing happy birthday.
Here we go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Evan. For our learning time today, I thought we'd talk a little bit about that first Easter Sunday morning. We opened our church service this morning with a wonderful song by Quote the Raven called Golden Hour. And as I was thinking about Easter and getting ready for Easter, I was laying in bed and listening to CBC, and their song came on. And I thought, wow. Isn't that Easter Sunday? Especially the chorus, and it says, I want to hold you in the golden hour. Every day, every minute, we're in it. Let me hold you in the golden hour. And I thought about the women going to the tomb on that Easter Sunday morning, expecting to find Jesus' body, expecting to prepare him for burial. And instead, they find an empty tomb. And I think they went wanting to hold on to the gift of Jesus. And instead they ended up with more questions than answers. But still, they held on to the memories and to the love. And as they journeyed through that first Easter day, as the gradual understanding of what had happened sinks in, they remembered the love, they remembered the stories. And it's like when we're gathered with our loved ones following a death, we tell the stories and we laugh and we remember and we cry and we grieve. And I think that first Easter Sunday was like that. But the women had something else to hold on to. The tomb was empty. There was something more. The story was continuing. And I think the same is true for us today as we continue to live out the story, the good news of that first Easter Sunday.
I'm so thankful for the generosity of the people of Cochrane Street United Church, whose generosity makes special services like this one today possible. We give you thanks for your generosity and your donations. In thanksgiving for all God's gifts of grace, the offering will be received.
What can I do?
What can I do?
What can
Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for the good news that fills our hearts today. You are indeed risen. We pray that you'll receive all that we have to offer, the work of our hands and the money we bring for the building up of your kingdom. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us pray. There are a million ways that you speak to us, God of the garden and God of the empty tomb. You speak to us in nature. Your artistry shows up in starry nights, in the smell of pine, in rushing water, and in most every sunrise. You speak to us through our relationships, the comfort of a loved one, the laughter of our friends, the security of those who support us and cheer us on. Lean down and breathe life into these sacred texts. We are craving to hear your word like never before. We are craving to understand, to see ourselves in the story. We are craving proximity to you. With hearts full of gratitude, we pray. Amen. We hear first from Isaiah chapter 25, verses 6 through 9. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. And this is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Our responsive psalm is Psalm 118, and you'll find it on page 837 in our hymn books. Let Israel now say,
God's love endures forever.
Let the house of Aaron say,
God's love endures forever.
Let those who fear God say,
God's love endures forever.
Alleluia, alleluia.
God is my strength and my song. God has become my salvation.
There are shouts of joy and deliverance in the tents of the righteous.
The right hand of God does mighty things. The right hand of God raises up.
The right hand of God does mighty things.
I shall not die but live, and shall proclaim what God has done.
God indeed punished me, but did not give me over to death.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Open to me the gates of the temple, that I may enter and give thanks to God.
This is the gate of God. Through it, the righteous shall enter.
I thank you, for you have answered me. You have welcomed my salvation.
The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is God's doing, marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
Save us, O God, we pray.
God, we pray, give us success.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of God.
We bless you from the house of God.
God, our God, has given us light.
With palm branches in hand, let us march to the altar.
You are my God, and I will thank you.
You are my God, and I will extol you.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Our gospel reading this morning is taken from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, beginning to read at verse 1. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll the stone away for us from the entrance of the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, who is our strength and redeemer. Amen. Every year on Easter Sunday, we read one of the gospel accounts of the story of the first Easter, that first resurrection story. And in our lectionary, that's the cycle of readings that we follow, they pair in each of the years one of the gospels, Matthew, Mark, or Luke, with the Gospel of John. Probably the reading from the Gospel of John is one of the most popular, and it is beautiful, and we love it for so many reasons. I love the way Mary mistakes Jesus for the gardener, and the way Peter and the other disciple are almost having a race to see who can get to the tomb, who can get to the tomb to see Jesus first. And I love it when Mary hears the sound of her name, when Jesus speaks it. As she hears Mary, she cries out, "Rabboni," with tears in her eyes, tears of recognition, tears of connection. So that is why, probably almost every Easter, I preach from the Gospel of John. But this year, Mark's gospel kept coming back to me and said, "No, this is not the year for John, Miriam. This is the year for Mark's gospel." And Mark's gospel is hard for a whole host of reasons. Mark's gospel ends with the women running away from the tomb, not telling anyone about what they had seen, because they're filled with terror and amazement. And more than that, as I learned this year, in the original Greek, the sentence is incomplete. It ends with the word "because." So it says, they went out from the tomb and fled. Terror and amazement seized them because. And that's it. There's nothing more. There's no reason given. There's no explanation as to why. And I think the silence of that ending has compelled us over the years to fill in the blanks. So if you open your Bible to Mark chapter 16, you'll notice that there is both a shorter ending of Mark and a longer ending of Mark. They are not the original ending, which is simply the word "because." The shorter ending has the women finally telling Peter and then going to Galilee to meet him there. And the longer ending includes an appearance with Jesus, meeting with Mary Magdalene and the disciples, going to Galilee, being commissioned to tell the good news all around the earth, and then Jesus ascending up into heaven. And I think the uncertainty of this ending is why it called to me this year. It is the reason that it suits me, because everything about this year is unpredictable. And maybe in many ways, this year has been an incomplete sentence. We live from day to day because it's hard to plan too far in advance, because we don't know what the next day is going to hold, which is a challenge for people like me who are planners. I like to have a plan, follow the plan, and if I must, find alterations to the plan that will help me get through. But this is not a year for planners with me. And as I read Mark's gospel, I think we can learn a lot about incomplete sentences, living our faith in times of unpredictability. In many ways, this past year, the uncertainty has pushed me further into my faith, help me ground more in the consistency of God's love. It never changes. As it says in one of the epistles, God is the same yesterday, yesterday, today, and forever. So we can rely on that, just as we can rely on the rhythms of the church year that are the same every year. We know that 40 days of Lent, 40 days of preparing, of getting our souls ready for the Easter season, lead us from Hosanna through Crucify to this day, to He is risen. So as we think about that first Easter and Mark's telling of that story, we know it's filled with uncertainty. On that first Easter, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, they gathered together the spices, and they're getting ready to go to the tomb where Jesus was buried. It's early in the day. The light is just coming up over the horizon. It's that beautiful, shimmering golden hour of the day. And they know what to expect, or at least they think they do. It's been 3 days since Jesus died. It's going to be a hard scene because Jesus' broken body has begun to decompose and the smell is going to be terrible. They are prepared for that. So as they walk, what they're trying to figure out is how they're going to roll the stone away, because Jesus was buried in a stone cave and the stone that was in front of it was almost like it was locked into place. And as they walk, they're talking about how they're going to move the stone. And when they finally arrive, they look up and they see that the stone is rolled away, and they can't figure out how that's happened. And they look in and they see no body, and none of this is what they expected to see. They expected the tomb to be locked shut. They expected Jesus' body, but they did not expect this. And then, as the horror of the situation is sinking in, they hear a voice. There is someone robed in white sitting on the right, and the voice says, "Don't be alarmed." How could they not be alarmed? This was terrifying. This was unexpected. This was not part of the plan. And the voice says, "Don't be alarmed. Go and tell Peter and the disciples that Jesus has gone ahead of you to Galilee, and we'll meet you there." And the women couldn't get out of the tomb fast enough. They were filled with terror and amazement, and they ran and fled because we don't know the because. Fear and terror are probably a good explanation. Women in Jesus' day had no standing. They would have been afraid to be witnesses of this account. But I think Mark was quite deliberate in how he chose to end the gospel. I think it's like one of those choose-your-own-adventure books where it's up to us to write the next chapter. We are the because. The very first line of Mark's gospel is the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, Son of God. And maybe Mark's gospel ends in the middle of a sentence because we are the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, Son of God. And it's up to us to tell the resurrection story. So instead of Easter being the end, it is really the beginning. And we are called, invited to tell the resurrection stories, to tell the good news that death has lost its sting, to tell the good news that we are never alone, to remember that Jesus always goes before us, and that the good news of abundant life belongs to everyone. And we are called and invited to live out that good news story in our own time and in our own place and in our own way. We are the because. And so as we think about that first Easter, and we remember that the women fled from the tomb, filled with terror and amazement, because we know the next part is up to us, and we are the bearers of the good news. So as you go about living your faith this day, think about how you can fill in the blank. Because? Amen.
Friends,
Friends, Jesus invites us to share this joyful feast.
People will come from east and west, from north and south, and take their places at the banquet in the kingdom of God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is truly right and our greatest joy that we should praise you. Hallelujah, thanks and praise, ever-living God, worker of wonders, maker of miracles, author of all life and giver of eternal life. Out of chaos and fear, you bring beauty and hope. Out of despair and death, you create new life. And so with the risen Christ who makes all things new, by the power of his resurrection, we join in the song of a new day to sing your praise.
Holy, holy, holy God, power of life and love, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna through the ages. Blessed is the one who comes to bring your justice to the earth.
Holy God, source of life and goodness, all creation rightly gives you praise. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us. He healed the sick and ate and drank with outcasts and sinners. He opened the eyes of the blind and proclaimed the good news of your kingdom to the poor and to those in need. In all things, he fulfilled your gracious will. On the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and after giving thanks to you, broke it and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took a cup of wine, and after giving thanks, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Gracious God, in Jesus Christ, you destroy the power of death, and by raising him to life, you have given us life forevermore. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Recalling his death, proclaiming his resurrection, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you, O God, this bread and this cup. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that all who eat and drink at this table may be one body, one holy people, a living sacrifice in Christ Jesus our Lord. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God most holy, now and forevermore. Amen.
And as Jesus taught his disciples, we too pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The bread that we break
is our sharing in the life of Christ.
The cup for which we give thanks is our sharing in the life of Christ.
My friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take and eat, for these gifts are for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Amen.
And together we pray, for the bread we have eaten, for the wine we have tasted, for the life we have received, we thank you, God. Grant that what we have done and have been given here may so put its mark on us that it may remain always in our hearts. Grant that we grow in Christian love and understanding, and that ours may be lives of faithful action. In Christ's name, amen.
Let us join together in our prayer for guidance. Let us pray. Holy God, dreamer of dreams, we offer Cochrane Street United Church to you. We are your people. This is your church. We come to you seeking your guidance, your purpose, your vision. Align our will with yours so that we will be willing to do whatever it takes to carry out your plan. We ask you to break through in new ways in our church. Show us the great ministry you have in store for us. Help us dream your dreams. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us. giving us the vision, boldness, and confidence to do all that you call us to do. Amen. My friends, let us go from this place to love and serve the Lord. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.